Robert's Rules of Order. Robert's Rules of Order, newly revised, commonly referred to as Robert's Rules of Order, RONR, or simply Robert's Rules, is the most widely used manual of parliamentary procedure in the United States. It governs the meetings of a diverse range of organizations, including church groups, county commissions, homeowners associations, nonprofit associations, professional societies, school boards, and trade unions, that have adopted it as their parliamentary authority. The manual was first published in 1876 by U.S. Army officer Henry Martyn Robert, who adapted the rules and practice of Congress to the needs of non-legislative societies. 10 subsequent editions have been published, including major revisions in 1915 and 1970. The copyright to Robert's Rules of Order, newly revised, is owned by the Robert's Rules Association, which selects by contract an authorship team to continue the task of revising and updating the book. The 11th and current edition was published in 2011. In 2005, the Robert's Rules Association published an official concise guide, titled Robert's Rules of Order, newly revised in brief. A second edition of the brief book was published in 2011. The first edition of the book, whose full title was Pocket Manual of Rules of Order for Deliberative Assemblies, was published in February 1876 by then U.S. Army Major Henry Martyn Robert, with a short title Robert's Rules of Order placed on its cover. The procedures prescribed by the book were loosely modeled after those used in the United States House of Representatives, with such adaptations as Robert saw fit for use in ordinary societies. Although he was in the military, the rules in his book were not based on military rules. The author's interest in parliamentary procedure began in 1863 when he was chosen to preside over a church meeting and, although he accepted the task, he felt that he did not have the necessary knowledge of proper procedure. In his later work as an active member of several organizations, Robert discovered that members from different areas of the country had very different views regarding what the proper parliamentary rules were, and these conflicting views hampered the organizations in their work. He eventually became convinced of the need for a new manual on the subject, one which would enable many organizations to adopt the same set of rules. Henry M. Robert himself published 4 editions of the manual before his death in 1923, the last being the thoroughly revised and expanded 4th edition published as Robert's Rules of Order Revised in May 1915. By this time Robert had long been retired from the Army with the rank of Brigadier General. The revisions were based on the feedback from hundreds of letters that Robert had received through the years. In addition, to explain the rules in Robert's Rules of Order Revised, Robert published an introductory book for beginners titled Parliamentary Practice, An Introduction to Parliamentary Law in 1921, and a full book of explanations titled Parliamentary Law in 1923. Through a family trust, and later through the Robert's Rules Association, several subsequent editions of Robert's Rules of Order have been published, including another major revision of the work. The 7th edition, published in February 1970 on the 94th anniversary of the publication of the first edition, was the first under the title Robert's Rules of Order Newly Revised. The subsequent editions were based on additional feedback from users, including feedback received by electronic means in recent years. These later editions included material from Robert's Parliamentary Practice and Parliamentary Law. The current edition of the series became effective on September 23, 2011 under the title Robert's Rules of Order Newly Revised, 11th edition. This edition states that the authorship team of the current 11th edition consists of a grandson of General Robert, an attorney, a lobbyist and legislative analyst, a mathematics professor, and a copy editor, all of them being experienced parliamentarians. More than 5.5 million copies have been printed. The following table lists the official versions of the body of work known as Robert's Rules of Order, developed by Henry M. Robert and maintained by his successors. Henry M. Robert III, grandson of the original author and trustee for the Robert's Rules Association, had acknowledged that there has been controversy among parliamentarians concerning the length of Robert's Rules in its various editions and the complexity of the rules it describes. As a result, a supplemental book was developed. In 2005, a shorter reference guide, Robert's Rules of Order Newly Revised in Brief, was published by the same authorship team and publisher as the 10th edition of Robert's Rules of Order Newly Revised, and was made to be in accord with that edition of RONR. A second edition of this shorter guide was published in 2011 to conform with the current 11th edition of Robert's Rules of Order Newly Revised. The In Brief book is the only authorized concise guide for Robert's Rules of Order newly revised and is intended as an introductory book for those unfamiliar with parliamentary procedure. The authors say, in only 20 minutes, the average reader can learn the bare essentials, and with about an hour's reading can cover all the basics. It is meant to be an introductory supplement to the current edition of Robert's Rules of Order newly revised and is not suitable for adoption as a parliamentary authority in itself. Since the copyrights for several of the original editions have expired, numerous other books and manuals have been published incorporating Robert's Rules of Order as part of their titles, with some of them based on those earlier editions. The existence of multiple editions and other variations, all published as Robert's Rules of Order, can sometimes cause confusion, as the various publications may differ in some details. Generally, Robert's Rules of Order is a guide for conducting meetings and making decisions as a group. The purpose of the book is to enable assembly as of any size, with due regard for every member's opinion, to arrive at the general rule on the maximum number of questions of varying complexity in a minimum amount of time and under all kinds of internal climate ranging from total harmony to hardened or impassioned division of opinion. The book is designed for use in ordinary societies rather than legislative assemblies, and it is the most commonly adopted parliamentary authority among societies in the United States. It is also recognized as the most widely used reference for meeting procedure and business rules in the English-speaking world. The book states that it is a codification of the present-day general parliamentary law. General parliamentary law refers to the common rules and customs for conducting business in organizations and assemblies. It does not refer to statutory legal requirements nor to common law precedent derived from court judgments. In other words, the book is about procedures for meetings and not about what is legal. As a reference, it is designed to answer, as nearly as possible, any question of parliamentary procedure that may arise. The 11th edition contains 669 pages of text, and all of its original content was included because it has at some time come up as a question of procedure somewhere. The completeness of the book was made so that organizations would not have to write extensive rules for themselves. In addition, members of different organizations could refer to the same book of rules. The contents of the current edition of Robert's Rules of Order newly revised, published in 2011, include details on the types of groups that use the book, the ways that decisions could be made, and the various situations in which decisions are made. The introduction in the book provides a history of parliamentary procedure and includes the background and history of Robert's Rules of Order. Rules in the book are based on the rights of the majority, of the minority, of individual members, of absentees, and of all these together. Some fundamental principles upon which the book is based include, one question at a time, one person, one vote, and a vote being limited to members present. A group that uses the book is called a deliberative assembly. The types of deliberative assemblies are a mass meeting, a local assembly of an organized society, a convention, a legislative body, and a board. An organization may have rules which could include a corporate charter, a constitution or bylaws, rules of order, standing rules, and customs to conduct business, groups of meetings or sessions that may be separated by more than or be within a quarterly time interval. The types of meetings are a regular meeting, a special meeting, an adjourned meeting, an annual meeting, an executive session, a public session, and electronic meetings. A member of a deliberative assembly has the right to attend meetings, make motions, speak in debate, and vote. The process of making a decision is done through a motion, which is a proposal to do something. The formal steps in handling a motion are the making of a motion, having a second, stating the motion, having debate on the motion, putting the motion to a vote, and announcing the results of the vote. Action could be taken informally without going through these steps by using unanimous consent. When making a choice, the basic principle of decision is majority vote. In situations when more than majority vote is required, the requirement could include a two-thirds vote, previous notice, or a vote of a majority of the entire membership. The book provides details about main motions including the motion to ratify. In addition, the book lists other motions and provides details on these motions which include details for each motion include its purpose, when it could be made, if it is debatable, if it is amendable, the vote required for adoption, and if it could be reconsidered. The order of precedence, or rank, of the motions is also described in detail. The second half of the book covers various topics in detail. Brief summaries of these topics are as follows. Depending on the situation, motions could be renewed, or made again. On the other hand, Members should not use legitimate motions for dilatory and improper purposes to waste time. A quorum, or minimum number of members, is required to be present at a meeting in order to validly conduct business. The business that is to come up in a meeting could be listed in an order of business or an agenda. Each member could get a chance to speak through assignment of the floor and debate. Debate may be limited in the number of speeches and time and should be respectful to others at all times. Voting takes place to decide the course of action and it could be done in a multitude of ways, such as voice vote, standing vote, and ballot vote. Officers in an organization could be elected through the process of nominations and elections. Each organization decides for itself which officers to have, but the minimum officers in a deliberative assembly are a presiding officer and a secretary. The secretary keeps the minutes, or the official records of the proceedings, for each meeting. As part of their duties, the officers may have reports to give, such as a financial report given by the treasurer. In addition, an organization may have a board to handle business on behalf of the organization. Officers and boards only have such authority and powers that are given to them in the governing documents of the organization. There may also be committees that are formed to assist the organization. The boards and committees may have reports to give as well. People may gather in mass meetings for a specific purpose or cause. One such purpose of the mass meetings could be for the intent of organizing a permanent society. Each organization has its basic rules contained in its bylaws. The bylaws could describe the name of the organization and its purpose, the requirements to be member or an officer, how meetings are scheduled, if there are boards or committees, its parliamentary authority, and how to amend the bylaws. Representatives from constituent groups may gather as delegates in conventions to conduct business on behalf of the organization. Conventions may consist of several meetings and may last for several days or more on an annual basis or other such infrequent interval. If members do not act according to the organization's rules, they could be subject to disciplinary procedures. Such action could range from censure to the extreme of expulsion from the organization. Officers could be disciplined by removal from office. The tinted pages in the rear of the book contain the following charts, tables, and lists: chart for determining when each subsidiary or privileged motion is in order, table of rules relating to motions, sample forms used in making motions, and motions and parliamentary steps, motions which require two-thirds vote, motions whose reconsideration is prohibited or limited, and table of rules for counting election ballots. In addition to containing a summary of basic points from the current edition of Robert's Rules of Order newly revised, the following contents are unique to the current edition of Robert's Rules of Order newly revised in brief: an example of an agenda, additional sample dialogues, frequently asked questions, an example of a call of a meeting, an example of a memorandum listing the order of business, and the following tables: handling motions as chair, when chair stands and sits, conducting a meeting as chair, table of rules relating to motions, and words to use as a member. The Robert's Rules Association has also made the 11th edition available in CD-ROM format through American Legal Publishing. The CD contains the current editions of Robert's Rules of Order newly revised and Robert's Rules of Order newly revised in brief, as well as a timekeeper's guide, teller's report, sample rules for electronic meetings, various forms, and resources for ballot voting and understanding secondary amendments. An e-book version of the current 11th edition has not been released by the Robert's Rules Association. Any copy of Robert's Rules of Order that is downloaded online is likely an older edition that is available in the public domain. Translations of any edition of Robert's Rules of Order into other languages have not been published by the Robert's Rules Association. Any translated copy of Robert's Rules of Order done by a third party may not accurately reflect the correct meaning in the target language. The following table lists some of the changes that were made between the editions of Robert's Rules of Order. The numbered pages may not correspond to the total number of pages in the edition due to additional material in the preface, introduction, and other miscellaneous pages that were not included in the numbering system. Generally, a fuller list and more details of the changes are found in the preface of each edition. A detailed list of changes for the current edition is provided in the website maintained by the Robert's Rules Association. All the changes were a result of questions and comments received from users. Starting in the period between the 10th edition and the 11th edition, the authors released official interpretations of rules in the book onto the website maintained by the Robert's Rules Association. The interpretations from that period were later incorporated into the 11th edition. In addition, The authors addressed common misunderstandings of the rules coming from frequently asked questions. Some of the misunderstandings involve: when the president can vote, if ex officio members can vote, the definition of majority, how abstentions affect the vote, a friendly amendment, calling the question, tabling a motion, getting items on the agenda, and the contents of minutes. While these misunderstandings are of the rules in the current edition of Robert's Rules of Order newly revised, the organization may be governed by atheros which supersede these default rules. The official interpretations and addressed common misunderstandings were a result of questions posted in the question and answer forum at the official Robert's Rules of Order website. This forum is actively moderated by members of the authorship team. In those cases in which the bylaws or other governing documents of an organization refer to Robert's Rules of Order, certain rules in the book may be subordinate to other specified rules, including any conflicting provisions in applicable law, the corporate charter, the constitution or bylaws, and special rules of order. In the question and answer forum on the website maintained by the Robert's Rules Association, members of the following types of organizations have posed dead questions regarding how the rules in the book apply to their specific organization generally. Robert's Rules of Order is designed for ordinary societies. However, lawmaking bodies at the local level function similarly to boards of societies. The book has found application to such bodies. Such bodies are also subject to open meeting laws and other applicable laws, all of which supersede any conflicting provisions in the book. On the other hand, legislative bodies at the state or national level have their own well-defined set of rules. However, a survey found that 4 state legislative chambers in the United States still use Robert's Rules of Order. Robert's Rules of Order is based on each member of a group having equal weight as expressed by vote. This book has found application in the corporate world, such as in shareholder meetings and in board of director meetings. However, the rules have to be modified to account for when some individuals within the group have more power than others. A parliamentarian is an expert on parliamentary procedure. To be effective consultants for the organizations they work for, parliamentarians are expected to be knowledgeable on Robert's Rules of Order. The National Association of Parliamentarians is the largest non-profit association of parliamentarians in the world. This organization bases its opinions and instruction upon Robert's Rules of Order newly revised. Membership in this organization requires passing an exam which is based on the first half of the concise guide, Robert's Rules of Order newly revised in brief. The American Institute of Parliamentarians is another non-profit association of parliamentarians. This organization stresses proficiency and familiarity with a variety of parliamentary authorities, although it states on its website that Robert's Rules of Order is the most frequently used parliamentary authority. The website also states that it is the premier manual on parliamentary authority and a must-have text for every parliamentarian. Youth organizations, such as Business Professionals of America, Family, Career and Community Leaders of America, Future Business Leaders of America Phi Beta Lambda, HOSA Future Health Professionals, the National FFA Organization, and Skills USA, sponsor parliamentary procedure competitions as part of their programs for their student members. These competitions are based on Robert's Rules of Order newly revised. The National Association of Parliamentarians have partnered with some of these organizations. Robert's Rules of Order are used in congressional debate, an event put on by the National Speech and Debate Association. Robert's Rules of Order is also used in model United Nations conferences. While the chair of each committee in a Moon conference may sometimes deviate from the written rules for educational purposes, the format of the rules in the specific committees is mostly based on Robert's Rules of Order. Another program in which Robert's Rules of Order may be used is Model Congress, although the rules in these programs may more closely resemble thus in the legislative assemblies that the programs simulate. Even if an organization has adopted Robert's Rules of Order, it can still adopt its own rules which supersede any rules in this book. The only limitations might come from the rules in a parent organization or from national, state, or local law. An example of a rule that organizations sometimes adopt is one that allows the use of proxy voting. Such a rule is not allowed unless the organization specifically provides for it in its bylaws. Parliamentarians have estimated that about 85-95% of organizations in the United States use Robert's Rules of Order. The remaining percentage of organizations use other books on meeting procedures. Notable examples of such books on parliamentary authority include the Standard Code of Parliamentary Procedure, Demeter's Manual of Parliamentary Law and Procedure, and Riddick's Rules of Procedure. These books, along with Robert's Rules of Order, share the general idea of rule of the majority with respect for the minority. A difference may be a simplification of the rules. Henry M. Robert III responded to the simplification by saying the following. Also in response to the simplification was the publication of a supplemental guide to the official book. In modern parliamentary procedure, the usual practice is having a proposal first, then discussion on this proposal with any modifications to it, and finally a vote on it, with majority vote deciding the issue if there are any disagreements. An alternative to this process is consensus decision-making. In this alternative, discussion of potential proposals is held first, followed by the framing of a proposal, and then modifying it until the group reaches a consensus, when there is no longer any disagreement. As a response to this alternative, the authors of Robert's Rules of Order stated their belief in using debate and majority vote as part of the process in making decisions for the group. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.